Thank you all. It's a pleasure to have Susan Herman back here in Oregon. This is one of her favorite haunts around the country, but she has been barnstorming the country to launch her latest book, Taking Liberties, that she'll be talking about tonight. I just wanted to tell you a few things about her background. She has been president of the board of the National ACLU since 2008. And I was chatting with her earlier because I couldn't remember how many presidents of the national board there have been in the almost 92-year history of the ACLU. I knew there hadn't been that many. She is only the seventh person to serve as president of the national organization. And it's important to understand that is a volunteer position. She is not paid for the work she does in trying to corral the herd of cats, which is our national board, which has 82 members, 51 of whom are representatives of ACLU affiliates around the country, and the rest are elected at large by the various ACLU affiliates. In her real job, Susan is a professor, the Centennial Professor of Law at Brooklyn Law School, where she currently teaches courses in constitutional law and criminal procedure and seminars on law and literature and terrorism and civil liberties. And I think the only other thing that's important to mention here is that the ACLU and Susan are both nonpartisan. It is our job as an organization to hold the government accountable, no matter who is in power, for violations of civil liberties and the Constitution, in particular, the Bill of Rights. And I think it's safe to say you will hear this evening about not only the erosion of civil liberties under the Bush administration, but also under the Clinton administration and the Obama administration. Without further ado, I give you Susan Herman.
Well, thank you, David, and thank you, Kevin. David is right. I come to Portland quite often. The last time I was here in April, and I was speaking at an ACLU dinner and also at the Portland City Club, and I was telling about the book I was about to come out and have published, and everyone kept saying, oh, you have to come back. You have to come back when it's published. You have to do a book event at Powell's. And to that, I kept saying, of course. Please, you may I. To me, you know, Powell's is, and I have some basis for comparison here, it's the best bookstore in the country. And, right? And I don't quite have the basis of comparison to claim that it's the best bookstore in the world, but it probably is. Right? So to me, this is like the platonic ideal of bookstores. So I'm really thrilled to be in Portland and at Powell's to talk about my new book, because first of all, you know, when you have something important to say, as I thought I did, what this book is about, it's about the impact of the war on terror on ordinary Americans, because probably you're here tonight because you realize that ordinary Americans are affected. It's not just those terrorists. And when you want to say something, you really want to have a discussion, I set out not only to talk about, you know, 9/11 stuff, but about if this is a book about the Constitution and about how the Constitution works. Excuse me. So if you want to get in more than a few sound bites, to me, books are still our chief form of communication. I was also thinking about the fact, coming in the door this evening, that books are also so much part of who we are as a country. And to me, reading and what people write in books and what we read in books is really part of our democracy. And so I was especially interested. Did you see the bowl full of little buttons downstairs, all sorts of different things? Well, the two that I fished out, one says freedom, always a good message. And the other one that I wanted to talk about here is Thomas Jefferson was a bookworm, which he was. Thomas Jefferson had the incredibly large collection of books. And in the War of 1812, when the British burned down the Library of Congress, you want to know how they got started again? Thomas Jefferson gave them a bunch of books from his collection. He had so many. So you know, he stocked the Library of Congress. So to me, the fact that we are in a bookstore tonight is so intimately related to the things I want to talk about. You all know that when the Patriot Act, which, as you know, is about to reach its 10th anniversary, was still new, in addition to the ACLU, the first people in this country who sort of sounded the alarm and said, we're concerned about some of these powers. We're librarians. We're booksellers. We're our friends at Penn, you people who are authors and who think, you know, who are interested in ideas. So I was writing, I have actually two chapters in this book about libraries and librarians and books and, you know, a number of different stories that I tell. But when I was working on one of the chapters, my husband got very interested in the idea of public libraries. And he said, well, you know, you really should do some sort of sidebar on the history of public libraries in the United States. And I could tell, you know, you don't really get a hyperlink in a book. So, but nevertheless, I did a little research just to sort of say, yeah, you know, to kind of appease him. And it was fascinating what I found out. It's not only Thomas Jefferson who was a bookworm, but the people who wrote our Constitution very much believed in books and believed in libraries. So I'll just give you one other example than Thomas Jefferson. The other great bookworm of all time was Benjamin Franklin. So Benjamin Franklin, I see you nodding, a lot of people probably know that he loved books so much he couldn't afford to buy enough of them. So he and his friends formed the first lending library, the Library Company of Philadelphia, and they all just agreed that they would exchange their books so that they could get to read more. So Benjamin Franklin, as you know, was very famous in his time. So there was a town in Massachusetts that decided to name itself Franklin after Benjamin Franklin. And apparently one advantage of naming your town after a person who's still living is you tell them, evidently the custom was, you tell them we're naming our town after you and therefore you have to give us something. Yeah, that's, you know, how you acknowledged and accepted the honor. So they wrote, you know, to Benjamin Franklin and said, we want to name our town after you and could you please send us a new church bill? So they get this big box in the mail. This is, you know, I'm sort of extrapolating the story. I don't know exactly how this happened, but this is basically the thrust. So they get an enormous box and they think, aha, Benjamin Franklin has sent us our church bill. They open up the box, it's full of books. And what it says, you know, the note from Benjamin Franklin, the cover note, which I imagine was on the top of the box, says, sense is better than sound. So there's Benjamin Franklin, and that's why it seems to me only right and just that it's the librarians and the booksellers in this country who have been the custodians of our intellectual freedom and of our democracy itself. When the Patriot Act, there are a number of different things. I read a lot of different things in this book, you know, all different areas, and probably the most familiar area to most people that you've read about in the news and so forth are the surveillance provisions in the Patriot Act. And I am going to talk a little about some of the surveillance provisions tonight, even though there are a lot of other things in the book, and then we'll see what you'd like to talk about in addition during the Q&A. I'll give you some rough suggestions. But the librarians' point on when they first saw the Patriot Act was they didn't like the whole concept of what the Patriot Act was trying to do. The idea, you recall, the Patriot Act was passed about 6 weeks after 9/11. And the title of the act, do you know this? Do you know about the acronym? Some yes, some no. Okay, so imagine that I have a PowerPoint up here and it says USA Patriot. Visualize those letters. Here is the name of the act. This is the actual title of the act that Congress passed. USA Patriot is an acronym for the actual title of the act, which is Uniting and Strengthening America by Providing Appropriate Tools Required to Intercept and Obstruct Terrorism. Somebody was up all night working on that one. So to me, I mean, what kind of chutzpah is this? You know, if 6 weeks after 9/11, they knew exactly what we needed to do to disrupt terrorism before anyone had studied what happened. So as you know, we have all these antidotes before anyone has diagnosed what the problem was. Well, the basic idea, because everyone was pretty panicky at the time, was let's just give the government a whole lot of power. Because we want to give the government all these dragnets, because what if there's a terrorist who couldn't be caught unless we give the government all these surveillance powers to find things out, unless we give the government all these powers to prosecute people for when they can't prove very much, unless we have all these security systems to allow the government to stop anyone they want from getting on a train, plane, or subway. So, you know, we just want the government to have more power. Well, one of the kinds of powers that the government was given was more power to do more surveillance and find out more about all sorts of things about all of us than would have been possible before that. And so this sort of starts with, because the librarians are so much part of this, I want to start the story with the librarians. Now, the librarians were very concerned that the Fourth Amendment, which, as some of you know, is the part of the Bill of Rights that guarantees the right of the people to be free from unreasonable searches and seizures. There are two basic concepts in the Fourth Amendment, that, as it's been held, that give content to the idea that we have the right to be free from government prying into our affairs and searching our homes and listening to our conversations. One of those ideas is that the government has to have a good reason for, you know, coming after you and searching your home or, you know, reading all your emails. Usually it's called probable cause, but it's always some form of individualized suspicion. We have a reason why we're targeting you. We're not just fishing to see whether or not you're doing something that might be of interest or concern to the government. The second idea is that usually you have to go to a court. And probable cause, the idea of does the government have a good enough reason, they have to convince a neutral and detached magistrate, is the Fourth Amendment term. You have to convince a neutral judge that, in fact, the government does have a good enough reason to get information on you or arrest you. And that's really a logical idea. If you're thinking of having an operation and your doctor says you need the operation, you get a second opinion. And that's all the Fourth Amendment is really all about, is, you know, let's have a second opinion. Very typical of the way the framers wrote the Constitution. There's always a check and a balance, and we don't put all the power in one place. Well, so the librarians were very concerned that this basic idea of the Patriot Act was, let's create all these dragnets and let's enable the government to find out more about people. Now, since I'm starting out by talking about people who write and people who write books, I want to quote to you, this in some ways was the essence of a lot of what I talked about in the book, but this is not by a lawyer, and so it's extremely well written. Elaine Scarry, who teaches English at Harvard, said the following thing about the Patriot Act, and I just think this is so apt. The Patriot Act inverts the constitutional requirement that people's lives be private and the work of government officials be public. It instead crafts a set of conditions in which our inner lives become transparent and the workings of the government become opaque. Either one of these outcomes would imperil democracy. Together, they not only injure the country, but also cut off the avenues of repair. Isn't that wise? And she writes it so well. You know, hear it for people who write. So that's what the librarians were concerned about. You know, the government is not telling us what they're doing, but they want the opportunity to come into libraries and find out what people are reading. So what the kind of thing the librarians were concerned about, I was just in Seattle last night, so I was focusing on a thing that happened in Washington State in 2005, where there's this librarian in Whatcom County, Washington, who actually has the FBI come to her library and say, we want to know the identities of all the people who have taken out this biography of Osama bin Laden. Whoa, you know, whoa. Yeah, okay, so now what's wrong with that? If the government can just be looking, who's reading a biography of Osama bin Laden, what happens? You know, people become concerned. They become afraid to take out a biography of Osama bin Laden because what if the government is going to be watching? So that was the librarians' concern. They just didn't like the whole notion of the Patriot Act. So let me tell you about the provision in the Patriot Act that became known as the library provision, because this was the first provision that the librarians flagged. But before I tell you about the librarians, a word from our sponsor. The reason the librarians knew what was in the Patriot Act was the ACLU people in the Washington office had put it all on their website. Okay, nobody could figure out what was in the Patriot Act. It's a 300-page printout, hundreds of amendments to previous law. And I was with the ACLU legislative lobbyist, Rachel King, whose job it was after this was passed, because there had been no hearings, no testimony, no debates, and she had to figure out, well, what's in this, and what should the ACLU be concerned about? So when the ACLU published this, okay, you know, here's this provision and here's what it does and it dilutes the Fourth Amendment requirements and et cetera, that's where it all started. So then the librarians start talking about, well, wait a minute, this is a problem. So here's what this particular provision did. Its section number was section 215, but I'll also call it the library provision, even though it's not restricted to libraries. What it said was, anytime the government wants to get any kind of information, records, tangible things, anything they want to find out about anybody from a person who keeps their records or their things or whatever, all the government has to do is to fill out an affidavit, fill out a statement, and submit it to the secret court, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, and say, we believe we might find something relevant to a terrorism investigation. You notice they don't have to say we suspect the person whose records these are, nothing like that, just we think we might find something relevant. And at that point, the statute says, the Patriot Act says, the government, the court must issue the order. Okay, so you notice two things wrong with this. We're missing the individualized suspicion. The government can fish around to see if they can find anything. And what's the point of getting the court order? Okay, you have a court order, but the judges don't get to decide anything. They don't get to review the government's reasoning. Okay, so this to me, you know, okay, it's technically a court order, but it's really nothing more than a fig leaf. What kind of information can the government get with this court order? Well, they can find out who checked out the biography of Osama bin Laden. They can also get medical records, hospital records. They can get records from, think about this one, your internet service provider. How many people know the term cloud computing? Okay, you know how much your internet service provider knows about you now? All that information that Benjamin Franklin used to keep, you know, scribbled out in the family Bible or in his desk drawer in his home, where the government couldn't invade his home unless they went through getting a warrant, etc., that's now not even just in your own computer. It's off there on the cloud. And who knows what's in all of your pictures, what's in your calendars, what's in your contacts, you know, what all the websites you visit, everything about you, your internet service provider. Okay, so this library provision allows a tremendous amount of power to the government, to the executive branch, without any real check from the courts. And Congress was paying no attention whatever to any of this. It's just, you know, oh, take these powers and do whatever you think is necessary. So what was interesting was that this was not actually the first occasion when the whole question of doing investigations in libraries came up. There had been a program during the Cold War that was called the Library Awareness Program. Not many people know about this. I don't know whether a few people, Candace knows about that. So a few people do, but most people don't know about this, and most people didn't know about it at the time. But what happened was that the FBI was asking librarians to please come and tell them about any books that were checked out by foreigners from communist countries. Okay, yeah, so, right, exactly. So this is to keep an eye on Soviet agents and what they're doing. So finally, this is going to sound a little familiar. In 1987, the public learned about this program because the New York Times broke the story. They wrote an expose. Let's hear it for the freedom of the press, right? Makes things a little better. So at that point, you know, the librarians, who hadn't actually been approached by anybody, were really outraged. They were saying, you know, how are we supposed to know who's a spy? We're librarians. You know, we're not security agents. So as a result of the Library Awareness Program, in reaction to that, 48 states, the legislatures passed laws to protect the privacy of library records. Now, when people talk about library records being special, nobody is saying they are sacrosanct and the government can never look at, you know, what the library records say. All we're saying is what the 48 states all said, which is in order to find out what somebody's reading in the library, the government really should have to get a serious court order. They really should have to show in neutral court that they really have a need for this. And in that case, all right. Now, I said 48 states, but in the other two states, actually, the Attorney General did the same thing anyway. So this is all 50 states believe that library records should be special. The point of the Patriot Act? To sweep all that aside. There had also been special state and federal privacy laws to protect educational records, to protect medical records, to protect the work, the records of the information that you give to a social work agency. You know, just think of, you know, all the secrets that people tell, you know, all sorts of other people who then have that information, as well as the internet service providers. But under the Supremacy Clause of the Constitution, the federal government has the power to just toss aside state laws. So that was the very point of the Patriot Act, to get around the state privacy protections, as well as previous federal protections of all this very private information. Well, those of you who are somewhat older may recall that in the fall of 2001, when the librarians were issuing all these statements, and you would go on the American Library Association website, and they would say, this is awful, you know, we can't have the government invading libraries and spying on what people think. Attorney General Ashcroft at the time first said, and this didn't turn out to be a very popular comment, he said, this is just baseless hysteria. Librarians are being hysterical. So, you know, he kept saying things like that, but the librarians, who were not as quiet as their stereotype, kept complaining and kept trying to, you know, raise the alarm and kept saying, you know, this is really a problem. So finally, Attorney General Ashcroft said, all right, I'm going to declassify information about how frequently we've used this library provision, and then you're all just going to calm down. Okay, you know, at the point of the four-year renewal period, the provision had been used 35 times and never in libraries. Now, it turns out there's a story behind that. The Department of Justice had been very slow about figuring out how they wanted to use this power. So, in fact, the power had virtually never been used. So he announces to everybody, well, this isn't being used in libraries. Now will everyone just calm down? Well, one of the heroes of my book, you'll be happy to know that I have heroes as well as villains, and that in addition to talking about ordinary Americans being the victims and the collateral damage of the war on terror, I also talk about the Americans who really stood up to defend the Constitution. And one of those people, who you can see in the middle of the book there, is George Christian, who was with Library Connection of Connecticut. And he was one of the people, you know, as many librarians around the country were, who were meeting with other librarians in Connecticut to try to figure out, well, what would they do if the FBI, in fact, came to them to demand library records? What should be their approach? Should they have procedures? Did they have a lawyer to advise them? Should they be just failing to keep records? Should they destroy all the records every day? You know, how they should they approach this? Well, when Attorney General Ashcroft said, well, we're not using the provision, he thought, oh, okay, well, you know, we can just relax. He said to me afterwards, yeah, it turned out to be a big mistake. So what was interesting was when Attorney General Ashcroft made that statement, we're not using the library provision to get information in libraries, there were a lot of librarians around the country scratching their heads because, in fact, they had had FBI agents come into the library to demand information. So they're thinking, what's going on here? Now, one of the problems is that the library provision, in addition to giving the government a lot of power to get the information, you know, power to find out what we're doing, also had the other side of Elaine Scarry's comments here, because it also prevented people from saying anything about what was happening. So there was a gag order built into the statute that said, and if the FBI comes to you, custodian of records or physical things, whoever you are, if you're working, you know, the administrator at a school or whatever, if the FBI comes to you and asks for information about somebody, you're not allowed to tell anybody ever that they asked you anything. You can't tell anybody ever anything about it. Well, it turned out that the reason that John Ashcroft could say, technically truthfully, that the library provision was never being used was that the FBI was going to libraries in many other places and asking for information under a different provision that nobody had focused on. This provision was called the National Security Letter provision. Now, there had been national security letters before the Patriot Act, but this is another part of the approach in the fall of 2001. It was very opportunistic. Let's take anything, any power the government has, and let's conscript it. Let's, you know, retrofit it. Let's just, you know, make it bigger and broader and able to do things. So the national security letter provision allowed the FBI, and some other agencies too, to go into some kinds of businesses, telecommunications, which includes telephone companies who know all the telephone numbers you call and from which you get calls, internet service providers, libraries. How many libraries have you been into lately that don't have a computer? So that's why they're covered. Okay, so telecommunications places, financial services, the FBI could just go in and serve a national security letter and demand information about clients of the telecommunications providers, librarians, etc., just because they said so. No court. No court at all. And this provision also had a gag order. So if the FBI came and said, okay, we want you to tell us all these things about your client or whatever, and the answer was, yes, sir. And you were never allowed to tell anyone. Well, George Christian learned about the national security letter provision because he was served with the national security letter. One day he's standing across from the tennis courts in Matatuck, Connecticut, and an FBI agent comes up and serves him with this demand saying, we want you to tell us who was using the following computer in this Connecticut library on the following day. Now, according to George, that would have been really difficult because they didn't keep records per computer. But he was even upset beyond this was really difficult. He just thought that this was wrong. And he was very concerned. He was especially angry because the Attorney General had been going around, as he said, telling everyone their library records were safe. And this was sure proof that library records were not safe. Now, I should point out that the national security letters don't allow the collecting of as much information. You can't get the content, so you couldn't actually find out who checked out the biography of Osama bin Laden. But you could find out names, addresses, all sorts of things. And if you go to an internet service provider, there have been different interpretations over time, but at least one theory that was in play for periods of time was that from an internet service provider with no court order whatever, you could find out all of the web addresses that somebody had visited and all of the to and from email addresses, you know, everyone who'd been sending that person email and everyone to whom that person sent email. Now, this was pretty complicated, and I was also talking to magistrate judges who found it very difficult to figure out how technically you separate the content of the email, which the government is not allowed to have under this power, from the addresses because they travel together. Okay, but that was another problem. So George Christian is very upset about this, and he's also concerned about the part that says he's not allowed to tell anybody ever anything about the fact that he's gotten this demand. One reason why he's concerned is that Library Connection of Connecticut, which is a consortium, of libraries, all of whom share internet services, and he's providing internet services to all these libraries. They have a board of directors. So he's trying to figure out what to do about getting this demand, and he's not allowed to tell his board of directors. So he was very upset about this, you know, just having to make the decision. So what he finally decided to do was to compromise and to just tell the members of the executive committee. So they became the Library Connection Four. I have a picture of the four of them here. So they talked about what to do. They went to talk to a lawyer, and the lawyer had never heard of national security letters. It was somebody who taught at the University of Connecticut at the law school, I believe. But fortunately, the lawyer had access to a law student who could do some research. And the law student discovered that there had been a case about national security letters. Not surprisingly, this case had been brought by the ACLU, surprise, and it was called John Doe versus Ashcroft. And this case was brought by an internet service provider who had also received a national security letter even earlier. So he gets a national security letter saying, give us the following information about your internet client. And I can now tell you, after the case that John Doe brought was amazing. It went on for 6 years, and for 6 years he was not allowed to tell anybody that he was the person bringing the lawsuit. The lawsuit was first called, when he started it, it was called John Doe versus Ashcroft, then it was called John Doe versus Gonzalez, then it was John Doe versus Mukasey, then it was John Doe versus Holder. The attorneys general were coming and going, but there's John Doe, still not allowed to tell anybody that this is his lawsuit. So he is a very courageous and spunky person. So in 2007, he wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post, signed, of course, John Doe, because he wasn't allowed to say who he was. And he described what it was like to live under this prolonged regimen of silence. He said, when I meet with my attorneys, I cannot tell my girlfriend where I am going or where I have been. I hide any papers related to the case where she will not look. When clients and friends ask me whether I am the one challenging the constitutionality of the NSL statute, I have no choice but to look them in the eye and lie. Well, John Doe and his girlfriend, I'm sorry to tell you, broke up because she had a feeling he was hiding something from her, which he was. He's doing fine now. He has a wife and a baby, and he's doing fine. But six years of litigation. When he first came to the ACLU, despite the fact that the gag order said you're not allowed to tell anybody ever anything, didn't make exceptions for lawyers, didn't make exceptions for you can go to a court, didn't make exceptions for you could testify before Congress. Okay, this John Doe, as well as George Christian and the Library Connection people, really wanted to testify before Congress. Because one thing that had happened under the Patriot Act, because Congress realized that they hadn't had time to talk about any of the controversial provisions beforehand, was some of the controversial provisions they had sunset, which meant that they were only good for 4 years, and then they would expire unless Congress renewed them. So 2005 was coming up, and Congress was considering whether or not to renew the library provision. Attorney General Gonzalez at the time testified before Congress, oh, we've only used this provision 35 times and never in libraries. Well, John Doe, the internet service provider, and George Christian and his three colleagues on the Executive Committee of Library Connection really wanted to say to Congress, wait a minute, there's something going on here that you may not be aware of. Library records are not safe. You know, here's what's happening. They weren't allowed to do that. The government said, you can't testify before Congress. You're under a gag order. You're not allowed to tell anyone anything about what you know. So imagine what this litigation is like. George Christian discovered what it was like to be a John Doe. They weren't allowed to go to the hearing in court on their own case, because if they went, somebody might have figured out who they were. So the hearing is in Bridgeport, Connecticut, and they had to attend the hearing by looking at a closed-circuit TV that was being shown in Hartford, 60 miles or so away. Okay, so this was really weird. So they're also discovering that, you know, there are some people who are beginning to guess. You know, the FBI is calling the homes and reporters are sniffing around. And Peter Chase, George Christian's colleague, was saying that he was horrified. One day his teenage son said to him, Dad, is the FBI after you? And Peter said, to his horror, he realized he couldn't tell his son the truth of what was going on. He wasn't allowed. So, you know, there are a lot of things going on. I'm going to resist telling you some of the other wonderful stories about the litigation. The whole litigation was absolutely bizarre, as the government was trying to keep everything totally secret. They said for a while, they told the judge that the ACLU should not be allowed to post on our website the fact that this litigation existed, because that would compromise national security. Okay, so, you know, that everything had to be battled. Okay, so the bottom line was we won both of those cases. So John Doe, in fact, the John Doe case, the original internet service provider, led to a ruling by a court in New York that that gag order, surprise, violated the First Amendment. Because even though sometimes, you know, maybe it's appropriate to have a gag order, but not in every single case permanently, always, as to everybody, and not even lawyers. So Congress very slightly amended the gag order to say, oh, okay, you can tell a lawyer. And okay, we'll set up a procedure where the court could, in fact, excuse you from the gag order unless the government says, no, they don't want it. Okay, so, you know, we got a tiny bit of crumb. So we obviously had to keep litigating, you know, the gag order and things like that. The Library Connection people were finally told, okay, you can testify before Congress after the hearings were over and the Patriot Act provision had already been renewed. So it turns out, you know, what do we have here? This story is emblematic of a lot of the different areas that I talk about in my book, because here's Congress just giving these vast powers to the executive branch, leaving out the usual involvement of the courts beforehand, leaving out congressional oversight to try to figure out what in the world the executive branch is doing here. And afterwards, when the courts are trying to get involved here, these two courts were actually pretty good. Most other courts that were involved in challenges to any of the Patriot Act provisions didn't do as well. There was another ACLU case that we brought in Detroit that was called Muslim Community Association versus Ashcroft or, you know, whoever the government person was. And that was brought by some Muslim and some, you know, non-Muslim social work agencies, people who had a lot of clients who were Muslim, who said, we're very concerned that the government is going to be looking to our records because they're going to want to find out more about people. And if the government comes to us and says, give us your records, we're not going to be allowed to tell anyone. And that's going to be a problem for us. So could you please rule right now that this is unconstitutional? Well, so the government comes in and starts submitting secret evidence to the judge and says to the judge, you can't actually litigate this because these are all secrets and, you know, nobody can know about this. So the judge gets very upset and sort of doesn't want to just say to the government, you're wrong. And there are all sorts of issues about, you know, whether people have standing. The courts have said, and this is just nuts, that in order to challenge secret surveillance, you have to be able to prove that you're actually under surveillance. Catch 22, right? Yeah, but the whole point of secret surveillance is they don't tell you, right? You know, they're not supposed to let you know. It turned out that judge in that case in Detroit, the government made a motion to dismiss the case, and the judge didn't rule on the motion to dismiss for 3 years. Just, you know, couldn't figure out a way out, just sort of let the case languish. So it's been very difficult to get the courts to really do anything in this area. Okay, now what I want to move to, having just told you one little story of things that maybe some of you didn't know about, you know, look at all these powers, is, so where are we now? A lot of people would say, well, so what? A lot of people say, well, why should I care if the government knows what I'm doing, if I'm not doing anything wrong? No, I suspect that's not your first thought in this room here. I think there are a lot of reasons for that. Number one, I think people should care because all this kind of stuff is going on a lot more than people realize. So national security letters. So as of the time in 2005 when George Christian and John Doe are challenging those, nobody really knew that this kind of stuff existed. There was an expose written by a Washington Post reporter which put numbers on these things for the first time. And as a result of this litigation of these two American heroes standing up and a brave reporter, we now actually can put figures on how often this happens. Anyone want to guess the number of national security letters we've had since the Patriot Act innately empowered them? Hundreds of thousands of requests. Now, on the one hand, think of all that stuff that's going on behind the curtain. Your telephone companies, the internet service providers are turning over all this information to the government. And I'm telling you the good news about the people who stood up to this. You want to know how many people actually have challenged the government on this, so far as we know? 6. The 4 Connecticut librarians, John Doe, and one other internet service provider who also came to the ACLU. Okay, now I think that's pretty alarming. Why do you care if the government knows all these things about you if you haven't done anything wrong? Well, first of all, examine in your own mind for a minute, have you ever done anything that the government might think was wrong on your taxes, on your whatever, or that might be embarrassing if it got out? You know, we all know, somebody was talking about the little quotes that I put at the beginning of the chapters because something you do when you're writing a book. One of my favorites is by Jenny Holzer, you know, the artist who puts the truisms in LEDs, like girls should be treated like boys. Well, what she says is abuse of power comes as no surprise. You know, when things are happening in secret, when you give one branch of the government all this power, and they don't think anybody's ever going to watch what they do. Is there going to be abuse? You betcha. So one of the things that the Patriot Act decided was that because they were kind of dealing out the courts were not going to be reviewing all these search and seizure applications, and they were also dealing out, they didn't really think that they needed to do very much. What the Patriot Act said was, well, you know, we'll just make sure that the agencies are really taking care of this. We'll get the responsible grown-ups in the agencies to be in charge. So, you know, in order to get this kind of order, you have to have somebody at least this level of seniority. So the FBI had all these procedures. After the exposés, and when Congress finally decided maybe it would be interesting to find out how this whole power was being used, they had the Inspector General of the Justice Department do a study on national security letters. His report in 2007 concluded that left to its own devices, allowed to use these self-initiating orders with no court involved, and without expecting that anyone was really going to be reviewing what they were doing, the FBI had racked up thousands of violations of its own regulations. Thousands. At a hearing in Congress, the FBI's general counsel said, okay, that's an F report card. But it turned out there was another report the inspector general wrote, which got worse. The FBI had gotten so lazy because all the telecommunications providers were just saying, yes, sir, you know, can we give you the information faster? They stopped even going through the national security letter provisions, and they just started asking for information by an email, by a post-it note, just, you know, totally casual. They didn't really keep records. The other thing that the inspector general couldn't figure out was whether they had ever gotten any information that had actually led to apprehending a terrorist, because the FBI wasn't really keeping track of anything like that. Plus, you know, there's one part in the report where he says, well, you know, I haven't found a lot of evidence that they ever found anything useful, except this one case where blah, 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 blah. You know, that's all redacted. So, you know, we can't know. Now, one of the problems here is that I think the American people don't really know what's going on in all these different areas. Another problem is that because of all this secrecy, it's first of all hard to know the costs, but it's also hard to know the benefits. My view is that after 10 years, it's about time that we found out. One of the issues, people say, well, you know, in addition to why should we care whether the government knows, people say, well, you know, how can you stop the government from getting all this information about people? In addition to the usual ways of compelling information, the government now can just buy information from data aggregators. They can Google things. They can find out all sorts of things. But there are still a lot of places where we can, in fact, put the genie back into the bottle. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that there is really no federal law protecting privacy. There's no law about the retention of some of this information. So, for example, what if the FBI focused in a total mistake on a totally innocent American citizen and thought that they had been involved in a terrorist incident in a foreign country, did all sorts of surveillance, you know, listening to conversations, reading emails, searching the home, you know, copying everything on the computer drive? What if the government just gathered all this information because they had this suspicion that turned out to be totally wrong? Okay, if that were to happen to somebody, and if the government were to apologize and to say, oh, we're terribly sorry, we got this wrong, you're innocent after all, and they still had all the information that they had taken from this person, including records of this lawyer's clients, the children's homework that was on the computer, do you suppose the government would have to, in fact, give back the information or, you know, cleanse it from its data banks? No. Okay, Brandon Mayfield is here with us tonight. This happened to him. And Brandon? So, yeah, he deserves a hand, because what he had to go through, we should all as Americans be apologizing for. And we should also take the... Yeah, we should, right. And we should take this story, which has a lot in common with what the librarians were complaining about, very seriously, and saying we really have to be controlling what the government is doing. The whole thing that most Americans bought in the fall of 2001, which is, well, we just have to trust the government. Yeah, at a time when people are so distrustful of our elected representatives, it's remarkable to me that people say, well, we just have to trust the government to know which of our liberties we have to give up in order to be safe. Okay, so I want to end my comments, so we will have some time with questions, by telling you why I wrote this book, because that's often the first question. People say, well, why did you write this book? So my opening anecdote, you don't want to give away the end of the book, but I think you can give away the beginning. I was at a dinner one night, and I was sitting next to this woman who was not, in fact, an ACLU member. And so she said to me, being polite, making conversation to the person to the left of her, she said, okay, tell me what the ACLU is doing these days. But don't tell me about that Guantanamo stuff, she said. I'm so sick of hearing about that. She said, why should I care about those people when they're not even Americans? so Gaff. Okay, so could anybody in this room have answered that question? Okay, well, I tried. And then it occurred to me that there was actually another thing to say, that there had been a lot written about that Guantanamo stuff and torture and targeted drones, etc. But what people were not talking about were the things that actually did impact ordinary Americans. And so I say after my opening anecdote, you know, she's wrong. And I give a little list, and here I'm just going to read you this list in closing so you can see if there are any of these things that you'd like to explore in the question and answer. She could be one of the hundreds of thousands of innocent Americans the FBI has been spying on using the broad net of the Patriot Act and supplemental powers. Her banker and her stockbroker, among many others, have collected financial and other personal data about her to lodge in government data banks, ready to trigger an investigation of her if the government happens to connect some dot of information to her dots, even if she's done nothing wrong. Her computer geek neighbor might be one of the innumerable telecommunications workers and librarians whom the FBI has conscripted to gather information on hundreds of thousands of occasions, perhaps about her friends or acquaintances, and then ordered not to tell anyone anything about their experience on penal criminal prosecution. Her nephew could be the computer studies student prosecuted for providing, quote, material support to terrorists because he served as webmaster for a website posting links to other people's hateful comments. Her son could be the college student detained and interrogated for packing his Arabic-English flashcards to study during a plane flight. She could find herself unable to complete an important business or personal trip because her name was incorrectly placed on a no-fly list, or simply because she has a common name like T. Kennedy. Her favorite charity could be shut down for years or even permanently because a government bureaucrat once decided to investigate it, even if the investigation went nowhere. Her generous contribution toward humanitarian relief might be sitting in government escrow for years instead of reaching the intended recipients or being returned to her. Her doctor's assistant could be the young Kashmiri American who was stopped and searched in the New York City subways on 21 separate occasions, even though the odds of the same person being selected for a, quote, random search that often are 1 in 165 million.
You've been listening to the president of the American Civil Liberties Union, Susan Herman, talking about her new book, Taking Liberties, The War on Terror and the Erosion of American Democracy. In a moment, we'll return to the question and answer session from the presentation. Susan Herman is the Centennial Professor of Law at the Brooklyn Law School. She teaches courses on constitutional law and criminal procedure, as well as seminars on law and literature, and terrorism and civil liberties. She is author of many articles and discusses constitutional law and rights issues in many venues of print and broadcast media, including National Public Radio, PBS, C-SPAN, NBC, and The New York Times. In addition to her most recent book, she is author of Terrorism, Government, and Law, National Authority and Local Autonomy in the War on Terror, co-authored with Paul Finkelman, and The Right to a Speedy and Public Trial. To find out more about Susan Herman and her work, please visit the American Civil Liberties Union website at aclu.org. And now we return to the question and answer session from the presentation. Susan Herman spoke at Powell City of Books in Portland, Oregon, on October 3, 2011.
So, what would you like to know more about, or what would you like to say? Ma'am? Speak loudly so the people in the back can hear your question.
The first member of the audience with a question asked the speaker what she thought about the term enemy combatant.
The term enemy combatant is a term that was used in order to put people in Guantanamo. What I didn't mention to you, what I should have, is that because of the Guantanamo stuff, you know, idea, I don't write about that in this book. So I'm happy to answer the question. In fact, I don't think that the president should unilaterally be declaring people to be enemy combatants. And that kind of, it's just, you know, what happened to due process. But that's not the only place where the president gets to unilaterally declare things. I was talking about the charities. I have a whole chapter in here about the war against Muslim charities, where the president got to just declare charities to say, okay, you can't give money to that charity, under a statute that actually was designed to allow the president to decide to blockade Libya. So, you know, I think it's a terrible problem, and I think that's another example of this just trust us. We're the government here, folks. You know, we the people. We're not supposed to be deferring to the government, giving away all of our rights. We're supposed to be telling them what we want them to do. And I just feel that, you know, it's about time for us to really look at, you know, whether they're doing things that are placebos, that are effective, that are cost-effective, that are maybe even counterproductive. Okay, other questions? Ma'am?
The next member of the audience asked who it was that actually wrote the Patriot Act and how they got so much written in just 6 weeks.
Yeah. Okay, how did they get so much stuff written in the Patriot Act in 6 weeks? A lot of it had been on the Department of Justice wish list for years. They were just powers that the prosecutors had always wanted. And this was, you know, a great occasion to say, okay, fine, you can do that. We're just going to take off the chains. There was a great ACLU report written about, you know, privacy that was called, during these years, called Bigger Monster, Weaker Chains. That's about it. Fred Neal.
The next member of the audience asked about the interpretations of national security letters. He commented that Oregon Senator Ron Wyden had been hinting at an interpretation that he himself is not allowed to discuss outside the small panel of members of the Intelligence Committee. This member of the audience asked, if we cannot know the government's interpretation of these laws, how can we possibly know the impact these laws might have on our rights?
It's a great question. I'm glad you raised that, because one thing that Dave was saying before, which is that I think a lot of people also relaxed about the Patriot Act and everything. When George W. Bush left the White House, they felt, well, you know, okay, he's gone, the problem over, you know, mission accomplished, you might say. You know, no more civil liberties problems. But it turns out that although President Obama really did try to take a different course as to Guantanamo stuff, torture, you know, he really took a different position on those. He has not taken a different position on all the things I talk about, the surveillance, the material support, etc. And what Fred is alluding to, which I'm glad you mentioned, is that the last time the library provision was just renewed was in May of this year, 2011, and Senator Wyden, as well as Mark Udall, who are both on the Senate Intelligence Committee, said in Congress, we can't really say very much about this because this is all top secret, but the Obama administration is interpreting this provision in a twisted way that we think would really anger people if they knew about it. So Dianne Feinstein said, maybe her committee should hold a hearing. That was May. Okay, hasn't happened. Fred is saying, how are we supposed to make the decisions if we don't know? That's exactly my point. We're the people. We're supposed to be the deciders. You know, the president is not the decider. We're the deciders. But how do we decide if we don't have information? Now, let me ask you a question to think about, because this is what it's all about. Why isn't Congress getting more pressure to hold that hearing? Why don't people care about this? I think some of it is, why should I care if the government knows about me if I'm not doing anything wrong? So that's one thing we have to confront. And another thing, which is totally illogical if you think about it, but a lot of people would like to believe this, is, well, we better leave it all alone. We must be doing everything right because, after all, there hasn't been another major attack. Okay, now I'm gathering those of you who laugh know something about the post hoc ergo propter hoc. You know, it doesn't mean we need all these powers. We don't know. You know, we don't know which of these powers contributed. Some of them pretty clearly did not, because some of them were just not very good ideas at the time. I'll indulge in one. The 9/11 Commission staff wrote a special report on terrorism financing. In the fall of 2001, one idea that went along with the Patriot Act, this is not totally within the Patriot Act, but one idea was the way to stop terrorism is to cut off the flow of money to al-Qaeda. And to the extent that that money is coming from contributions to mosques in Brooklyn, we'd better investigate all the charities in America, and we'd better make sure that nobody is giving money to terrorists, and therefore we're going to make all these businesses jump through hoops and start anti-money laundering programs, etc. There's a fascinating report by the 9/11 staff, which they did separately from the main 9/11 Commission report, which says the model doesn't work. You know, money laundering is about patterns of money laundering. We don't know about patterns of terrorism. We don't have the algorithms to look at all this information to figure out who's going to be a terrorist. Plus, it seems that this whole idea of the pipeline just wasn't true. It's wildly overblown at best. So, but for 10 years, we've been doing that. The Treasury Department is really making life hell for, you know, charities and for, you know, all these businesses that have spent billions of dollars doing Patriot Act compliance. Has anyone come across the Patriot Act compliance software? You have to have it for all the list checking and all. So, you know, why aren't people saying to Congress, you know, we don't want you to be doing this? They're not going to change unless they hear from us. Sir, in the back.
The next member of the audience suggested that one reason that there aren't many people alarmed by these attacks on our constitutional rights and civil liberties is that they're too busy just trying to make a living, just trying to get by in very tough economic times. Another reason people might be keeping quiet is fear, a worry about the kind of activities that can get you targeted for surveillance. Right now, there are over 20,000 people on the terrorist watch list, the no-fly list, and it seems you can get on this list rather easily, with somebody anonymously expressing some suspicion about you.
Okay, well, let me mention a couple of facts again. I have, you know, a chapter on that one, too. My idea of, you know, you can't really do sound bites and talking, that's why I wrote the book. You know, clearly I can't tell you everything that's in the book just by, you know, chatting for half an hour here, which is why you're at Powell's where you can actually buy books. Isn't that fortunate? But let me indulge by telling a couple of stories from chapter four there, because what you're saying is exactly right. You know, the no-fly lists are compiled in secret by people who are never going to have to be accountable and explain how they reached those conclusions, often based on hearsay. I have a picture in the book of Eric Scherfen from Pennsylvania. Eric was a Gulf War veteran, and while he was in the Gulf there, one of the things that the military was doing, which was great, was sensitivity training. They were teaching the soldiers over there about Islam so that they would be able to deal with people better. Well, he became very intrigued by Islam, so when he came back, he decided to convert, met a woman, they got married, and they now run a Muslim bookstore, and he works as a commercial pilot. So one day his employer says to him, you know, we're going to have to fire you if you can't get off the no-fly list. Yeah, we can't have a pilot who's on the no-fly list. So Eric ends up, you know, he tries to deal with the Department of Homeland Security. I don't know if any of you have ever dealt with the DHS trip forms. So he applies for a redress control number, and then he gets another one, and he's not hearing anything. He finally gets the letter. I'm not going to stop and look for the letter for you, but it's an unbelievable letter that you get after the whole process where they say, okay, we got your complaint, and we looked into it, and if you were on a no-fly list, and if you shouldn't have been, then we've done the appropriate thing. Yeah. Okay, why was he on the no-fly list? One of the documents that came out when he tried litigating this to say, you know, what's going on here? Why should I be on the no-fly list? Is it because I'm a Muslim? Are you suspicious that every single Muslim is a terrorist? So it turned out that one of Eric's coworkers who knew that he was a Muslim did seem to be a somewhat biased person. And he reported to the FBI that Eric was retrofitting his car to carry bombs. His evidence for that? Eric had removed a broken seat from the car. Okay, I'm going to be doing a talk on my book in the Central Library in Philadelphia, and Eric and his wife Rubina are going to come and tell their story, and I have a picture of him with his helicopter. But that's the kind of thing. Let me give you one more example of airport security practices, because this is another one where if you need to tell your friends, why should you care? This story is one of the two stories that I tell that people say, whoa, wait a minute, that could be me. You know, that's not just somebody who's a Muslim. So Nick George was a college student at Pomona College. He's 22 years old. He lives in Philadelphia. In August, he's flying from Philadelphia to go back to school. He's become interested in Middle Eastern studies because look at all this stuff going on. So he's studying Arabic. It's a long plane flight, so he brings his Arabic English flashcards to study on the plane. Okay, so a TSA officer stops him and says to Nick, who had been 14 at the time of 9/11, he says, do you know who did 9/11? And Nick says, Osama bin Laden? And the guy says to him, and do you know what language he spoke? Now do you see why these cards are suspicious? Okay, seems funny. 5 hours, they had him locked up in a cell at the airport. They interrogated him. He missed his flight. He was terrified. He did the logical thing. He became a client of the ACLU. And we now have this case called Nick George versus TSA, where we're trying to get like a little more accountability. What's wrong with giving the government too much discretion? Every single area, one thing I think is interesting is that even though I'm sure most of you have read some of the accounts about, you know, Brandon's story about things that happened under the Patriot Act, when you start putting all these different areas together, there are all these themes that just tie everything together. The framers were right. It's not a good idea to give too much discretion to one part of the government without oversight, without accountability, without some sort of check. Sir?
The next member of the audience said that he is extremely afraid of the United States government and that he has been that way for a very long time. Just a few days ago, the United States government murdered a U.S. citizen in Yemen, the American-born Muslim cleric Anwar al-Awlaki. What are the speaker's thoughts on this case, and where might these policies lead us?
Well, you know, that's a problem, too. And it's the same thing. You were talking about designating enemy combatants. Well, Mr. Al-Awlaki, the president designated him to be somebody who should be killed, and he's an American citizen. Now, in Awlaki's case, you know, what everybody says, you know, properly first is okay, and it sounds like he was doing some bad things. But if the president has the power to designate an American citizen to be killed, not in a theater of war, but in Yemen or in Pakistan or Chicago, you know, where does it end? And at some point, the president is going to designate somebody who's innocent. And in the meantime, you're also going to have collateral damage. So I agree, the ACLU was not just afterwards saying, oh, wait a minute, that's a problem. You may have read in the news that we tried suing first. Mr. Awlaki's father was an ACLU client, and he was trying to challenge the government's decision that they were going to kill Mr. Awlaki. So we were supposed to end around 8:30. Is Kevin here? What do you think, Kevin? One more question? Okay, you have your hand up highest, sir.
The next member of the audience said that he had heard that the building that is being built for the new Homeland Security headquarters is bigger than the Pentagon. He was wondering where the speaker believes that agency will be going with the powers that have been granted to it by our government.
Well, you know, you don't have to extrapolate much. I was just reading, and I don't have an attribution for this, so I have to give this to you with a grain of salt, but I just read somebody saying that our country spends more money on anti-terrorism national security efforts than every other country in the world combined. And part of this is the private-public partnerships. People often ask me, well, you know, who's profiting from this? Why is all this happening? There's a lot of that, too. Yeah, we're spending a lot of money. A lot of people would say, well, it's worth it because, after all, we're safe. Now, I think what we don't know is we don't know whether all these powers are worth it, whether all the controversial powers are working. We don't know what their costs are. We don't know what their benefits are. We don't know which are actually counterproductive. This whole campaign against the Muslim charities, terribly counterproductive. All sorts of, you know, Muslims were really, now they're terrified of the FBI and never want to talk to the FBI again. So I think it's a real problem. As I say, it's about time that we really had a good inquiry about what's happening. So let me close with, I want to do two things. First, I want to close with a quote that I have on the conclusion from William Douglas, because this is, you know, a lot of, it's probably come to your attention as an educated group that it was just the 10th anniversary of 9/11. You notice any mention of that anywhere? Okay, now, in what you were reading was their coverage of what's happened to our civil liberties since 9/11? You know, some yes, some no. Okay, so, you know, that's why we need to talk about this now, and that's why my publisher decided, instead of having the publication date of my book being around 9/11, better a few weeks later, when everyone's thought about the buildings and the grief and the victims and the first responders, and then we can think about where are we. Well, there was one article in the Times that talked about civil liberties, I happen to know, because I was quoted in it. And Adam Liptak said, well, you know, it's not earthquakes, it's just tremors. Well, you know, first of all, West Coasters, if you're feeling tremors, possibility of earthquakes. So switching metaphors, here's what William Douglas says. As nightfall does not come all at once, neither does oppression. In both instances, there is a twilight where everything remains seemingly unchanged. And it is in such twilight that we all must be most aware of the change in the air, however slight, lest we become unwitting victims of the darkness. So, having done what my most recent review said was sobering, yeah, I feel, you know, my friends say, so are you enjoying going on your book tour? And I say, you know, I feel like Cassandra, you know, I'm saying to people, this is worse than you think. So, you know, in some ways it's not that much fun. So I would like to end on a lighter note, if you'll indulge me for a moment, because Powell's is in fact the best bookstore in the country, perhaps the world. And I was thinking about the fact that, you know, in some ways, it's amazing to be on a book tour and to be here at Powell's. It's such a fantasy. And it was reminding me of a cartoon that I saw a number of years ago in The New Yorker that, you know, for those of you who read books and perhaps write books, it's really about what keeps you going while you're writing a book, you know, the rewards of writing in addition to the substance. So you'll see how long ago this was, and I'm paraphrasing. But in the cartoon, there's a man who's sitting at a typewriter, and he has his head in his hands, and there are crumpled up pieces of paper all around on the floor. So that's how long it was. It was a typewriter. And a woman, obviously intended to be his wife, is saying to him, all right, let me go through it once again. The New York Times says you're the brightest new voice in fiction in a decade. Elaine calls up and wants to know, should she reserve a private table for you in the corner at her restaurant? Bill Moyers wants to do a segment on your life and thought. Now hit those keys. So this for me is a fantasy come true, to be at Powell's doing a book event. So thank you all so much for being here.
You've been listening to the president of the American Civil Liberties Union, Susan Herman, talking about her new book, Taking Liberties, The War on Terror and the Erosion of American Democracy. To find out more about Susan Herman and her work, please visit the ACLU website at aclu.org. This program was produced by PDX Justice Media Productions of Portland, Oregon. To find out more about our work and to access our growing library of free on-demand streaming video and audio programs, please visit our website at pdxjustice.org and write to us with your questions and comments at pdxjustice@riseup.net. We'd love to hear from you. Many of our programs are available on DVD and Blu-ray video discs. Please write to us for ordering information. Thanks for tuning in, and thanks for supporting listener-sponsored radio, public access cable television, net neutrality, independent bookstores, and all forms of grassroots, democratic, community media.